Welcome to the WhyD3 show for the month of May. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. We put this show together from our home studio in the Baltimore, Maryland area. We appreciate your interest in the show and taking the time to watch this month's edition. If you're not familiar with the WhyD3 show, or this is your first time watching, the show is dedicated to the student athletes, coaches, administrators, and others in Division III who dedicate themselves to the ideals of the division to discover, develop, and dedicate. We focus primarily on what individuals are doing off the fields, courts, mats of competition to make their communities better. We can't do this show without your support and ideas. Follow us on Twitter at YD3Show or using the hashtag YD3. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/YD3Show. You can also email us at YD3Show at D3Sports.com. Share your ideas, thoughts, questions, whatever you have with us. This month's show will feature student-athletes who are making a difference and leading by example. In our student-athlete spotlight, we'll shine the light on a young man who's making sure you understand autism isn't a disability. We'll introduce you to Liam Crotty from North Central, who isn't allowing his high-functioning autism to stop him from playing football for the Cardinals. But more importantly, find out why his autism wasn't even part of the conversation when being recruited to play in college. We also take you to Stevens Institute of Technology and introduce you to the newest chair of the National Student Athlete Advisory Committee. Amanda Ingersoll will not only give us a better understanding of how the National SAAC works, but how they are changing the way they communicate with hundreds of thousands of Division III student athletes, and what important issues will be in front and center leading up to January's NCAA National Convention. We'll also introduce you to the National SAAC Vice Chair and hear his take on being a student athlete in Division III. Plus, we tip our hat to the Randolph-Macon SAAC and show you why they were the recipient of the April Diversity Spotlight from the NCAA. We'll also go through our honor roll, which includes a student athlete who not only played sports all 4 years in college, but played three sports all 4 years while tackling a major physical deficit. We'll also update you on the latest decisions by the Division III President's Council, which has approved moving forward on raising dues in Division III and adjusting next year's women's basketball tournament. And we show you this month's YD3 in three words. That's all coming up on this month's YD3 show. And when we come back, we head to Naperville, Illinois, and shine our spotlight on Liam Crotty, who isn't letting autism and its stigma stop his passion to play football. We'll be right back on the YD3 show.
I did receive a non-athletic scholarship upon entering school.
I got the presidential scholarship, which was huge for me.
I think there's more opportunities for academic scholarships in Division III.
I did receive academic scholarships. Just being involved on campus, being a leader, all those things combined kind of get me recognized. It's a great experience for me.
Every season starts with hope and a dream to play for the ultimate title, to become NCAA national champions. And you can experience it live at the 2015 NCAA Division III Baseball Championship, May 22nd through 26th in Appleton, Wisconsin. Hosted by Lawrence University, the University of Wisconsin-Oshkosh, and Fox City's Convention and Visitors Bureau. Affordable tickets now available. Visit ncaa.com/tickets today and make a date with champions.
I used to never really talk, ever. I was afraid if I said something wrong, everyone would laugh at me. But then I started to play golf with Special Olympics. It helped me to find my voice. And now everyone else is speechless.
Welcome back to the May edition of the YD3 show. I am your host, Dave McHugh. Don't forget, you can interact with us on social media. On Twitter, follow us at YD3Show or use the hashtag YD3. On Facebook, you can find us at facebook.com/YD3Show. And you can email us your thoughts, ideas, questions, etc. YD3Show at D3Sports.com. It's now time for our student athlete spotlight. We head to Naperville, Illinois, to be inspired by a young man. We introduce you to Liam Crotty, who plays football for the North Central Cardinals. Now, Crotty isn't the star player on the team. In fact, he's their backup kicker. But that isn't what makes his story so unique. Crotty was good enough to be recruited by some very good football programs in Division III, despite the fact no one recruiting him knew he has autism. Autism is currently diagnosed in 1 out of 68 children. Many of those diagnosed learn to adapt to their communities thanks to help from their families and specialists, and many end up being incredible members to society. So it probably shouldn't be a surprise that Crotty is a member of the Cardinals football team, but that isn't all he's doing to contribute at North Central. And I'm now joined by Liam Crotty, who's of the North Central football team, but certainly involved in other things on the campus. And Liam, first and foremost, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. A fascinating story, to say the least. We talk about students who have all kinds of challenges when they are athletes, whether it be in the classroom or certainly maybe injuries or something along the lines. You're taking on the special needs a little bit and making sure to embrace that as well as who you are while not letting it affect what you can do. You got to have a good support system around you.
Absolutely. My family, you know, they've been the best they could ever ask for. Our coaches, our teammates, it's been a very big blessing for me.
Give us a little bit of the background, because I certainly don't want to tell your story too much. Give us an idea of how autism became part of the reality, as it were, in your life.
Just a quick rundown. When I was 6 years old, I was diagnosed with a high functioning autism. Like, I knew that, but like, I never let it just be at the top of my head. You can't do this because you have autism, whatever. And I actually would like to thank my mom, because the day I committed, when she posted on Facebook to tell everybody, my son committed, but she told me, I wasn't supposed to graduate high school, definitely not supposed to make it to college. So if I would have had that set in my mind when I was a younger kid, that I really would not be sitting here right now talking to you on Skype.
Basically, you were told that you could do anything. It didn't matter the diagnosis or what the challenges might be ahead of you. Give me a little bit of a sense. Autism is a wide-ranging diagnosis in many ways. You say high-functioning. Does that mean Asperger's or something else?
It just means, I process things differently. You guys might have one way to figure out a solution, I would just have a different way, but the point is we'd get the same thing.
Yeah, I read somewhere you said that doing a math problem, you and I might look at the same math problem and do it two very different ways, but the answer is pretty much the same. Mm-hmm. How do you use that in the classroom? A lot of times, teachers want to see your work, as it were. Your work's going to be a little bit different. How do you work through those challenges?
I'll talk to a teacher. I honestly will tell them, here's a different way to solve this. Not just the basic whatever the teacher was teaching.
Obviously you were 6 years old when you were diagnosed, and there's certainly a social side of autism that I think many people maybe associate with it more than the intelligence side. Everybody who has autism that I'm aware of is probably pretty smart. There's a social side of things. So how are you able to adjust to your surroundings and adjust to your community when you were young, and how is that now helping you in college?
You don't let it get to you. That's basically it. Just be you, and it's other people's problems what they think of you or not.
That's certainly true. You got to be yourself. How much has sports? I have a feeling I know the answer to this, but how much has sports helped you in the social side of this, and helped you maybe even come out of your shell a little bit?
Oh, everything. I've played 5 sports in my life. I played football, basketball, baseball, hockey, soccer. It's just connections you make with your friends, your coaches, and their families, and it's incredible. It's awesome.
How much have you learned through sports, or what might be your favorite sport? And what, I guess maybe it's football, And has it helped you drive forward?
Yes, it has. And coming in North Central really helps, because our coaches always preach about being an All-American father, husband, academic student, and then an All-American football player. And they really try and prep you for after college, after football, rather than, you know, just focus solely on what you can do on the football field. And that's what I really appreciate about it here.
Certainly going to North Central is an easy decision when you're from the area. You're from Naperville. It's where you grew up. Obviously, that is part of your life. But what was it about a small school like North Central that was so appealing to you? Was it the fact that you might get the chance to play football? Was it the chance to be in an environment that would help you with your autism?
I feel like it was definitely a helpful environment, because it's a school of about 30,000, 3,200 kids. It's got that high school feeling where, like, you can always ask professors help and you can probably get it, because at a big school, like any Big Ten school, you know, you're just shunned away, where you have like 800 kids in a class. And like here, I've had no bigger than 30 or 40, which is, it's just really nice. The professors here are very helpful, and knowing that I was going to be able to play football was spectacular for me as well, because I wasn't exactly supposed to be here right now.
I'm going to ask a question I just don't know the answer to, so I'm kind of curious. Were you recruited to play at North Central, or did you decide to essentially walk onto the team?
I was recruited here. I was recruited by North Central, and I got heavily recruited by Co., Wisconsin, Platteville, and Robert Morris, NAIA. Those were like probably the top four I had.
You had some good teams there. Part of the story that I read online at North Central's website, which was very interesting, was you said that at one point you decided to come out and tell your teammates and your coaches that you had autism. Was that something that was not part of the conversation prior? Was that something that the coaches didn't even know in recruiting, that you kind of kept to yourself?
Yeah, they didn't know. We had a freshman meeting and everyone was telling something about what we didn't know, anyone else didn't know, and we had a kid on our team talk about how he had a tumor surgery. He survived the tumor surgery.
Wow.
And I kind of was very inspired by that, so I just kind of figured, why not? I mean, sooner or later, everyone's going to find out.
Sure. And how was that news received?
Everyone kind of just went like, their eyes were open. They're like, wow, I would have never expected that. But they're still some of my best friends to this day, so I'm thankful for that.
What are the challenges you face on the football field, whether it's the autism or just being a student athlete in general? What was the first year like?
It was not bad. I guess it was so different, because in high school, well, growing up, I played all positions. I played quarterback, running back, linebacker, safety, whatever. In high school, I played safety and I kicked my senior year. So in a practice, you're doing something every single second of practice. But here, like, it's different, because I just kick and I only get so much time. We only get so much time to actually do our drills and everything. So I guess just like not being as active, which, you know, it's a little different.
When you decided to take on college and then take on football, I'm sure your family both encouraged you while at the same time tried to make sure you knew what you were getting into. What was the best piece of advice you got before getting to college?
Don't dwell on your high school accomplishments, because the kid next to you was just as good as you, if not better. So everyone there was just like, this is my dad. He said, everyone is just as good as you, if not better. So you guys are all going to be, you know, competing, you know, extremely hard. It's just like there's no one that's just completely worse than you. You're as equal as everyone else.
You are not only involved in football, you have certainly gotten involved in the rest of athletics in a broadcasting point of view. Seems from what I've read that is certainly another passion of yours, whether you knew it before college or not. You've called basketball games. You've called softball games. Is being involved in the athletics department on the whole just something that, that helps kind of drive you?
Absolutely. With our radio station, WONC, 89.1 FM for the record, with our athletics department, we've been doing a rotation of who calls the basketball, baseball, softball, and it's been a lot of fun, get a lot of good experience, and it's just a ton of fun. It's just something I'd really like to do someday.
Does having activities like the football team, like working for the radio station, almost help you in some cases? You were talking about how you struggled in football a little bit, not being active the entire time during practice. I have this sense that your mind is very active and you want to stay active.
Yeah. Usually, like, and it's kind of hard because usually, like, the only time we get to kick before practice is usually our Sunday night practices, and because we don't have class, so we can get out there anytime we want before practice, but our practices during the week, I have 25 minutes to come from class to practice, and it's just not enough time to get like all the work we can possibly get in.
When you look at the future, you've still got 3 more years, technically, to play football. Would you like to be more than a kicker? Would you like to try your hand at safety? Do you think you get a chance?
If I get the chance, I'll do it. If they need me to play, I'll play. It might take a little time to get back into the groove, but I think it'd work.
When you, what are you studying, by the way? Have you decided? I know it's still your freshman year. You don't have to.
Broadcast communications major.
Broadcast communications? Well, then you're getting certainly plenty of experience, I'm sure. When people come up to you at class, when people come up to you walking through campus or whatnot, are you treated differently, or are you treated just like everybody else?
Just like everyone else.
That's got to be rewarding for you.
It is, because they don't see the autism in me, and it's definitely rewarding, yes.
Autism certainly affects a lot of people, especially as they get older. There's a lot of questions on how to help people who have autism, and certainly of more severe kinds and not high functioning. I'm kind of curious, do you want to be an advocate for autism? Do you think you have become an advocate for autism, or is it just something that is you and you'll lead by example?
I think it's just something I'll try and lead by example. I'd like to see a lot more kids with an autism become college athletes. I think that would be pretty neat. Doesn't really matter what sport either.
There's a lot of reasons that Division III probably works for you, being the fact that you can play on a team, the fact that you're at a small college, the fact that there's no pressure because you're a student first and an athlete second. But I'm kind of curious, in your first year in Division III, what have you learned about it that you have come to appreciate?
Everyone's there to play for the love of the game. No one's on scholarship. No one's 99.9% of us will not play after college. You know, that they'll be the rare, you know, two kids from Division III that get to play in the pros. But everyone's there for the love of the game.
What's your dream job to have in the future, or at least something you hope you'll be doing in your future?
I really hope to be doing ESPN somewhere, either if it's in Connecticut or Chicago. It's really been a big dream of mine.
I gotta ask, being from Chicago, which of the baseball teams do you root for?
I root for the White Sox.
Well, I should have known that before we started this interview, this Cubs fan here. Can't believe you said that. But that's okay. We won't hold it against you. Are you a Bears, Blackhawks, and Bulls fan as well?
I'm not a Bears fan. I'm actually a Miami Dolphins fan.
Okay.
I am a Blackhawks fan and a Bulls fan.
Very good. I'm sure you're thrilled with the way the Blackhawks and Bulls are going right now. Maybe someday in your future you'll be covering them professionally.
We'll see.
When you look back at what has been obviously a very busy first year, what's your favorite memory so far?
Favorite memory? It's a tough one. I think I'd like to say our Platteville game when we played them here. It was the first game I got to dress for. And it was just a big crowd. It was like the game of the week. It was number 6 and number 8. And when we went up 21-0 with 6 minutes to go in the first quarter, our special team, my kicking coach said if we put up, you know, however many more points, you'll get a shot to kick. Unfortunately, we didn't. We ended up winning 28-7, but still, just the big crowd feeling for a Division III game was really cool. It was just the big atmosphere. I enjoyed it a lot. It was probably my favorite memory.
I forgot to ask, are you living on campus or are you still living with your family?
I live on campus.
What's it like to live off, you know, away from the family, essentially?
It's definitely different, but the thing is, I live about 45 minutes away in Sandwich, Illinois. But so my parents aren't, you know, too close, but they're not too far away. Where if I need something, either one can drive out here, and it's good to have it. And I have family 25 minutes away the other way in Addison, so I have family all around.
Man, that's perfect, to say the least. I'm sure you have a lot of great friends on campus. I'm kind of curious. There's a lot of people who have their own ideas of what autism is. If you were to try and tell people in just one chance to tell people what autism is or debunk anything they may not understand about autism, what would you tell them?
I would say it's not a disability, it's a different ability.
That is perfectly said. Hey, Liam, thanks so much for joining us here on the show. I really appreciate it. We'll look forward to seeing your continued success on the gridiron, as it were, and, of course, behind the microphone. We look forward to hearing you call some games.
All right. Appreciate you for having me on here.
Absolutely. Thanks so much. Liam Crotty from North Central. Congratulations to Liam Crotty. It's very impressive how he's tackling college head on, but also being an integral part of the football team and contributing to the coverage of other student athletes and teams at North Central. And I love his quote, "Autism isn't a disability, it's just a different ability." Let that stick with you, because it really does say it all when it comes to those with autism and their contributions to society. Up next on the WhyD3 show, we will look at some of the business of Division III, including why the division is taking the recent budget deficit to heart and looking to do something themselves to help. Plus, the Women's Basketball Championship will officially be just a little bit different next year. And still to come, we talk with the National Chair of the Student Athlete Advisory Committee and hear from the Vice Chair. That's all coming up on the WhyD3 show.
This is the pinnacle of men's college lacrosse.
We have ourselves a ball game for the national championship.
Only the very best make it to the championship round, but only one will celebrate as NCAA national champions.
And the train keeps on rolling.
Experience it live. 3 days, three championships, the ultimate lacrosse experience at the 2015 NCAA Men's Lacrosse Championships, May 23rd through 25th at Lincoln Financial Field in Philadelphia. New affordable ticket options are available. Visit ncaa.com/lacrosse.
What makes D3 special is the ability to participate in my team and within the broader community.
The perfect ending to a perfect season.
Being a D3 student athlete has completely expanded my life.
I learned how to lead. I really found a voice.
What time is it?
It's game time!
It's more about the experience rather than just a sport itself.
Without the experience of being a Division III student athlete, I wouldn't be the person who I am today.
NCAA Division III. Discover. Develop. Dedicate.
Division III allows you to give yourself to other things.
Having that free time allows me to pursue the things that I want to pursue.
Division III athletics affords students the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport.
It allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. I wouldn't change it for the world.
Welcome back to the May edition of the WhyD3 show. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. Don't forget, you can interact with us on social media. On Twitter, follow us at WhyD3Show or just use the hashtag WhyD3. You can also look us up on Facebook at facebook.com/WhyD3Show. Or you can email us your thoughts, ideas, questions, whatever. WhyD3Show at d3sports.com. The Division III President's Council met recently and moved forward on a couple of key items that will have some long-term effects on the division. The first is pushing forward the idea of raising dues in the division. The last time dues were raised in Division III was 3 decades ago. It's currently $900 a year. That's it. Believe it or not, in Division I, it's only $1,800 a year. The President's Council has now charged or mandated the Strategic Planning and Finance Committee to formulate options for a dues increase. According to the NCAA, feedback from across the division is favorable of possibly doubling dues to $1,800, the same as Division I. There is also some inside politics in how Division III will be able to keep all of the money from those increased dues, which we can certainly better tackle on future shows. But it's at least important to note that dues increase is coming and could be voted on as early as this January's National Convention. But we won't know the exact timing or the increase plan until the end of this summer. And talk about money, the President's Council approved the 2015-16 proposed budget, which includes championship and non-championship enhancements. One of those championship enhancements includes changing next year's women's basketball tournament, officially rubber stamping the championship game being moved to Indianapolis, where it will be played on the same court as the Division I Final Four and Division II title game, similar to what the men did in Atlanta back in 2013. The biggest key for the women is they aren't adjusting the postseason tournament as much as the men were forced to do. The first two weekends will be conducted as usual, with two rounds of games being played at each weekend at a host school. The semifinals will then be played at the predetermined site on the third weekend, but the two remaining teams will then have to wait 16 days to play their title, which will be on Monday, April 4th at Bankers Life Fieldhouse, home of the Indiana Pacers of the NBA and the Indiana Fever of the WNBA. The Women's Basketball Committee will be taking bids for those interested in hosting the semifinals, which will include a championship dinner and community service that usually coincides with the championship weekend. And the Women's Lacrosse Championship Tournament has been approved to increase from 38 to 40 teams in 2016, allowing for one more first-round game, increasing the first round to seven games. Of course, when it comes to the decisions and legislation in Division III, the National Student Athlete Advisory Committee has an important voice, including as a voting member of the Management Council, which is a step below the President's Council. The President's Council doesn't tend to vote on anything that hasn't been approved by the Management Council. Coming up, we'll talk to the new chair of the National SAAC, but first we wanted to hear from the vice chair, who talked with the NCAA on a number of different topics. Here is Dominic Fremoni, who plays football for Concordia Moorhead in Minnesota and is an exercise science major.
The value of college sports really extends beyond the field. It teaches you a lot about professional development, working with others, and so many other things are going to translate into the professional world. But also, specifically, what I love about the Division III level is they're constantly encouraging participation in other areas. They want us to use the education we get in the classroom and the education that we get on the field. I keep saying field because I'm a football student athlete, but field, court, ice, course, to reach beyond ourselves as an individual and get out in the community. And I think that's the value of college athletics, especially at the Division III level. I would encourage those that want to go into college athletics to get involved. There's so many opportunities to further your education through experiential learning, beyond the classroom, and just once you get involved, be present in whatever you're doing. There's no point getting involved in a group and just sitting there. Really being present and being active in your commitments is a great way to develop in your collegiate career as an athlete and as a professional.
I suspect we'll hear more from Dominic on future WhyD3 shows. When it comes to Division III, there are a lot of misnomers, myths, half-truths, you name it. For the most part, it is a misunderstood division for those on the outside or don't have someone to explain it better to them. To tackle those challenges, it usually is up to coaches on the recruiting trails to not only battle possible misunderstandings about the division, but sometimes to change the minds of students and hopefully convince them why Division III is the right fit. Coaches and colleges are getting help from the NCAA headquarters to try and tell high school student athletes what is great about the division, but that doesn't mean the message will always get through. Sometimes it takes going to another division and then transferring to a Division III school to totally understand. During Division III week back in April, Endicott College in northeastern Massachusetts featured several of its student athletes who had transferred from Division I programs and have a completely new point of view on the division. The athletic department was kind enough to share their video with us.
more about like a lifestyle balance with school, friends, family, and I think that Endicott is a good balance of it rather than Division One.
Just in my head, I was going to play Division One lacrosse, and so I didn't even, there wasn't really any question in my head. It was, that's what I was working towards and that was my goal.
I think I didn't think it was as serious as Division One. I think when I was looking to commit, I thought it was like Division One or nothing. Like I had to get to Division One.
You just pick it for the sport because you want to be like that young kid is like committed to the D1 school and like that publicity, I guess.
One of the big things I'd heard was it was more or less like glorified, at least for football, I was told it was glorified high school athletics, but actually being here and experiencing it for a season, it's the furthest thing from the truth.
I think the competitiveness and everything is a lot higher than I was expecting, or I would have thought when I was in high school, and getting here and seeing that the competitiveness in practice, the drive, like the will to win, everything is the same. It's just a different time of commitment.
I knew then what I know now. My college process would have looked completely different. I would have started with the actual schools and locations and the individual coaches themselves rather than the Division I like, program rather than the record. I would have looked at like the team dynamic and the school dynamic.
I was never able to do a residence assistant. I wasn't able to join a lot of clubs because I was traveling, going to games, having practices, and now I'm able to do that with, I'm able to be an RA and get involved in nursing and different clubs, and I can also, I have the opportunity to study abroad.
If I knew that when I knew now when I was going through the whole like recruiting process, I probably would have focused more on the whole school aspect and focused on me and like what I want out of like college rather than just set like picking the sport and where I want to go play and what level I want to play at.
It seems like I keep getting proven wrong. Every opinion I have prior, it just keeps getting changed. So it's been a really great experience here thus far.
I definitely would have considered Division III as an option.
Glad to hear from student athletes on why it's so important to be part of the college athletics and what is going on in Division III. Coming up next on the WhyD3 show, the chair of the National SAAC, Amanda Ingersoll, joins us. We hear what the National SAAC is focused on in the next year, what changes are coming to how they communicate with the thousands of student athletes across the country, and what Ingersoll hopes to accomplish as chair. That's all coming up next on the WhyD3 show.
I know sports is important, but having the academic part along with it is a big plus. I've discovered in myself, you know, a newfound ability to overcome adversity at all different angles.
At a Division III school, school is really shaped around you developing yourself as a complete individual. The end result in my mind is you just become a very well-rounded person.
Before I came into college, I didn't really think I'd be able to balance so much. It helps a lot that you have a family with your team that can guide you.
With a D3 school, there's a lot of time for other opportunities. The coaches expect a lot of you during soccer, but after soccer, that's your own personal time to really find out who you are and other opportunities that you can pursue.
By balancing all of my interests, basketball, my leadership skills, and academics, I'm able to better prioritize my life and to manage it.
There's beauty to behold in a perfect serve, excitement in a fast-paced rally, and when the opportunity strikes, you go for the kill. The best college tennis in the country is coming straight to you, and you can experience it live at the 2015 NCAA Division III Men's and Women's Tennis Championships, May 18th through 23rd in Mason, Ohio, hosted by the Warren County Convention and Visitors Bureau and Ohio Northern University. For more information, go to NCAA.com and make a date with champions.
Welcome back to the May edition of the WhyD3 Show. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. Don't forget, you can interact with us on social media. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/WhyD3Show, or just use the hashtag WhyD3. You can like us on Facebook at facebook.com/WhyD3Show. And of course, you can always email us your thoughts, your ideas, questions, anything you have, WhyD3Show@D3Sports.com. The National SAAC has a new chair, as happens every year, and the new chair is the former vice chair of the group, Amanda Ingersoll of Stevens Institute of Technology. The women's lacrosse star and mechanical engineering major is wrapping up her senior year and graduates this month. But as with most chairs, will stay on through the NCAA National Convention in January. And she is now joins us to chat about the upcoming year and what she hopes the National SAAC can accomplish. And I'm now joined by Amanda Ingersoll, who is a senior women's lacrosse player at Stevens Institute of Technology, better known as simply Stevens. And Amanda, thanks so much for joining me. We should mention also the chair of the National SAAC. First and foremost, congratulations on that honor. I'm sure you kind of saw that coming being vice chair last year, but it's certainly an honor, I'm sure, for you.
Yes, thank you. And thanks for having me.
Absolutely. First and foremost, SAAC meetings held in the month of April for a few days, the new group, as it were, on the national side, getting to meet each other for the first time, though you probably knew some of each other from previous meetings in previous years, or at least meeting at the NCAA convention. What was it like to kind of get everybody at the same table, as it were, and get the new year off and running?
Yeah, it was great. We introduced the April meeting last year, and it really is a great meeting to get those new members on board so that when we hit July meeting and we have a lot of business to take care of, we kind of can hit the ground running. We don't have to worry about orientation and getting everyone up to speed. Everyone's already up to speed, and we can kind of get right going on the stuff that we need to get done. This year, we were fortunate enough, like you mentioned, to actually have 3 out of 6 of our oncoming members be at the NCAA convention along with about 80 other student athletes. And so we got a chance to kind of meet them beforehand, and they got a chance to kind of see what we were all about before their first meeting. So it definitely helped out for them, but the April meeting as a whole got all 6 of them on board. They're ready to go. They're right in there with us. So we're excited for this year.
Yeah, it's important you guys get yourselves orientated with each other, as you point out, which is great to see the April meetings added for that. But you also decide, I assume, who will be on the management council and how you will probably vote on those issues that may be presented to the management council. So as much as it's getting to know each other, it's getting right down to work, too.
Yeah, always.
Let's talk a little bit about the work that the SAAC does. And first and foremost, the SAAC has certainly come a long ways in just the 20 years I've been familiar with it. But more importantly, it's now the model for Division I and Division II. I'm sure that's still the topic of conversation around the table as well. What's it like to be kind of pointed out by the upper divisions, as it were, as a model that's worth being adopted there as well?
Yeah, that's something we're really proud of. And to us, it was second nature. We've always, since I've been on the committee and for years now, had that voice on management council. We've had those voting members on management council. And to think that Division I and Division II hadn't had that is really unfortunate. But it's a proud moment for Division III when those two divisions can kind of look at us and see the positive things that we're doing and the positive impact that that representation on management council by a student athlete has. And for them to adopt that is really awesome, and I think beneficial to the NCAA as a whole.
How important is it to literally, I mean, student athletes in Division III are certainly important because you're students first and foremost. So how important is it to have that word and that voice in meetings, in the national convention, as I've talked about previously? I think you guys were on the side that got voted for, whatever was for or against something, on all but one of the issues. How important is it to be able to have that kind of voice as a student athlete, and especially as a student?
There's so many constituents in the membership of the NCAA. You have athletic directors, you have SWAs, you have coaches. But the bottom line is all of that is coming back to affect student athletes. And without student athletes, the NCAA wouldn't really have a purpose. And so to have our voices heard is really special for us, especially when it comes to balancing the student and the athlete part of what we do. We have a lot of stresses that are unique to being a student athlete, and a lot of views and insight that we can share with those administrators and share our stories and share kind of the views of student athletes across the country that we represent. And I think that insight is something that helps for management council and president's council and all of the membership of Division III to kind of get an idea of what student athletes are feeling. And the bottom line is they want to hear our voices because they want to make the decisions that are best, not only for themselves, but for student athletes. So having that input on management council and even having a chance to sit down and talk to president's council and talk to our conference administrators is a really big impact. And we recognize that, and we're really grateful that we have that opportunity.
Talking to Amanda Ingersoll here, senior at Stevens and, of course, national chair for the SAAC. And, Amanda, let's talk about some of the issues you guys have on your minds coming out of your first set of meetings and really some of these transition from the last group from last year. First and foremost, the You Can Play initiative, which you guys debuted, as it were, at the National Convention in January. We featured it on last month's show. And, of course, this was something that kind of in Division III got jump-started by the NAC conference a few months earlier. What's so important about this campaign? What's the next step for this campaign?
This campaign is so important. It's a great organization You Can Play, but there are so many other organizations out there and so many other people out there focusing on the same thing, and that's making sure that every student athlete, regardless of their sexual orientation or regardless of just who they are as a person, is accepted for who they are and what they bring to that team. That's something that's close home to all of our hearts, I think, in that we want to feel accepted on our team regardless of who we are. And that's something that the national committee felt very important. And we took steps to make sure that that was communicated to the entire association and to the entire membership of the NCAA. Going forward, we obviously produced our video, and thank you for sharing that on your last show. But we really want to get student-athletes from across the country involved beyond that. We wanted to set the example, but we want institutions to create their own videos. I know that it's happening at a rapid pace now. There are so many more You Can Play videos going up. There's pledges being signed. There's people getting involved. And the most important thing is the conversation's been started. And so we just want to continue to foster that conversation and provide resources when we can to keep that conversation going in a positive direction.
When you talk about this campaign, what was the initial reaction? You talk about a lot of videos getting released, and you're right, I've seen a number of them by schools, and it certainly also spearheaded some other campaigns. But what has been the reaction to that? What was the reaction maybe in January? What was the reaction to this day?
The reaction we got was really positive. You know, sometimes these topics are hard to talk about, and we recognize that, but we wanted to put this out there in a way that made people feel comfortable. And we kind of put ourselves on the line. You know, it's something that is uncomfortable and it does conflict some points of view, but we put ourselves out there not as only talking about LGBTQ students, but also just talking about acceptance of diverse groups of people. And I think that point of view really sat well with everyone. People came up to us and thanked us, and you know, just it takes one person coming up to you and saying thank you, you made a difference, to just validate all the work you put in. And knowing that there are so many people that were affected by this video and affected by this movement is something that we're so proud of at the National Committee, and so proud of so many institutions and conferences across the country who are helping to keep this movement going. To date, we've just seen so much improvement in the conversation and keeping that conversation going. And so even though that was a huge focus on the committee last year, really want to make sure we don't drop that, and we want to keep it going and keep the momentum going.
Really quickly, does this have a personal, and I don't mean you, but I mean personal from your team, personal from your school point of view, where you've seen already a difference or maybe even inspired you?
Yeah, I think, like I said, I'd be hard-pressed to find someone who this doesn't personally affect, whether you yourself are an LGBTQ student athlete or you know one. Chances are somehow this is going to affect someone you know. And even if you don't know that it's affecting them, knowing that there's someone out there that you're affecting is just a great inspiration on the inside to keep trying to create positive change. And like I said, one person that's day is made better, or who feels included or accepted on their team because of something you're doing, is just such a great accomplishment that we're really proud of.
You certainly want to give you guys an applaud for that, and of course look forward to seeing how that moves forward. But of course that's not the only thing on your docket, as it were. You hinted a little bit about this. You guys want to even do more for the communication with student athletes. I almost get the feeling that you guys feel that some student athletes don't really know what's going on with the SAAC and maybe not even on their own campus. So what are you guys going to do moving forward to even open up the communications even more if possible?
Yeah, this is something we talked a lot about at our April meeting. And, you know, without communication, the work that we do on the national committee isn't going to get back to students. And the work that student athletes are doing on their campuses isn't going to get back to the national committee and to the association. And so that's a really big focus for us this year, is finding the best ways to communicate to student athletes and for student athletes to communicate back to the NCAA. Two things that we've kind of focused on to begin with, and we're going to try out and hope those work. The first is we put together a working group to help create a video, which will actually be shown at NCAA compliance meetings at each institution at the beginning of the year. So that video is really meant to educate student athletes on how their voice can be heard and how they can get involved in the NCAA and the legislative process. And, you know, there's a lot of talk about the student athlete voice, and we want student athletes to know how that voice can be heard. On the other end, we want to make sure that we're communicating what's happening in the NCAA so that students are educated enough to have that voice be heard. And so after each of our in-person meetings, so that'll be four meetings a year, so four reports a year will go out, and they'll just kind of highlight not only the things that the National SAAC is working on, but also things that are going on in the association as a whole. And it'll be a brief summary, so it'll be easy for student athletes to read quickly and get the information that they need to know. But it'll also provide links to important resources for those students who want to learn more and who want to get involved. And I think that'll be a really great resource for student athletes who want to get their voices heard.
Certainly is impressive, the amount of communication that is needed in some capacity, but at the same time, how much SAAC has grown and just adding to the communication, I'm sure is something you're looking forward to, but at the same time, can be a little bit overwhelming. What are the strategies that you guys hope to imply? I mean, social media, I'm sure, but at the same time, are you hoping this can be a grassroots on the campuses as well?
Yeah, that's the really important part. Social media is a great tool. You can reach a lot of people fast. But in order for us to really have an impact, we need those grassroots on those campuses. We need to take our role as National SAAC, go back to our conferences and have those conferences go to each institution and really educate them on what's going on and also get their feedback back to us. That's something we focus on a lot when it comes to legislation, as in we go to each school in our conferences that we represent and gather their input. But we really want to expand that kind of approach to other platforms or other initiatives, rather, like the You Can Play Project, like the It's On Us campaign, or other initiatives that we really want to get to campuses, Special Olympics, how to report that. Those kind of topics are really important, and we want to kind of get that same feedback both ways and get that communication going both ways.
It's certainly going to be fun to watch what you guys do with that. Of course, there's other things that are on your docket. We don't know legislation necessarily coming up for January. We certainly know a few things that are in the pipeline, but they got to get through a few councils to get to January. So certainly nothing to tackle there. But big one coming out of the convention that I know is on your radar may not be something that we're voting on in January, but I know you want to have a voice in, and that is the number of games being played by student athletes in different sports, on top of the fact of just maybe overall practices. First and foremost, you guys spoke against having the bill adopted. You spoke for having it be sent back and looked at all over again. And certainly the voice, it seemed, at the convention was, listen, we understand where this is coming from a budgetary point of view and maybe some other points of view, but we need to look at this wholeheartedly. This has to be looked at from a very broader point of view, but also a very narrow point of view, sport by sport, instead of an all-encompassing, hey, we're just cutting 10%. What's the situation with looking at all these number of games and all these sports and practices, and what do you hope for from an SAAC point of view?
Yeah, so this is something that student-athletes are really passionate about. Even when we were gathering feedback for last year's legislation, we had student-athletes from across the country write us letters saying that they don't want to lose their games. As student athletes, our games are what we play for, and so that's something that's really important, that we protect those games and that competition that we play for. However, we do think that things need to be relooked at. It's been probably 10 years since the number of games have been looked at, and maybe some sports are playing too many games, but there might be other sports who are playing the perfect amount for that student athlete, and so we want to make sure that it's not just a blind cut across the board. It's really looked at as a whole. Beyond that, we would rather also explore other options for budgetary concerns, looking at the non-traditional season, looking at championship access, looking at all these different areas that we can focus on rather than cutting games to address those budgetary concerns. And that's something that we've really hoped to be in the conversations of, and we have been since convention. You know, there's no official working group or anything going like that, but this committee's been approached and asked for our opinions, asked what do you want to see happen and what don't you want to see happen. At our April meeting, we kind of talked about how since this hasn't happened in a while, since we haven't been up this budgetary wall in a while, this is kind of an uncharted path. But what they want from us and what Management Council wants from us, President's Council, and I think the membership as a whole, is to kind of define what student athletes feel as far as boundaries are. What is something that we would not support? What is something that we would consider supporting? And kind of giving them those what-if scenarios and a list of, you know, if you're going to look at budgetary reasons, this is the first thing you should look at. This is the second thing. This is where game cuts come in on that list. And kind of that conversation as a whole is something that's going to be a focus of the entire association over the next few years, specifically in Division III, and is going to definitely be a focus of student athletes.
You kind of touched on it. It's a tough topic. You're talking about looking at some sports and saying, listen, you're playing too many games. We're going to cut two. You guys are fine, but you're playing more than the program we just cut by two. You over there, you're playing far too many. We're going to cut you by more than 10%. Hey, let's look at practices, which obviously was a big deal in football at the convention. We're going to look at non-traditional seasons, and I'm going to take an extreme here, so it's nothing on the table. But we're just going to cut non-traditional seasons. I mean, there's things across, you know, basketball, 4 weeks of preseason. Is it necessary? There's a lot of things this is going to open up. This is an all-extensive review. Is there also some concern as a result that it may open up and reveal some things that maybe people didn't want to see cut or changed or altered? It almost feels like, you know, we're opening up a Band-Aid a little bit here. We're going to see the nitty-gritty truth to everything, and some hard decisions have to be made.
Yeah, I think no matter what the topic is, when you go for an all-inclusive view, that's exactly what you're going to get. You're going to get the positives, you're going to get the negatives, and you're going to have to take a real step back and look at everything as a whole, whether you want to or not. And we recognize that on the National Committee. We recognize that there are some things that we might have to sacrifice in order to preserve other things. But the important thing is figuring out exactly what we're willing to sacrifice, what we will fight to protect, and the balance between those two.
Is it also hard to keep the Division III compared to Division I scenario out of the mix? A lot of times when people talk about these issues, and they did leading up to the convention in January, they're saying, well, come on, we're playing X amount of games. In Division I, they're already playing Y amount of games. We're not even at that number. We're below that number. This isn't fair. Is it tough to kind of not compare the division to other divisions? Because really, in all intents and purposes, Division III is different in that sense?
Yeah, and that's exactly it. Division III is different, and it's hard to separate yourself as a student athlete from a Division I student athlete, because you feel in the bottom of your heart that you are just as much a student athlete as they are. And so it's hard to say, okay, well, I'm playing Division III, so I deserve to play this many games where someone at Division I can play more. But that's exactly what we have to do. We recognize that Division III is different, and I think that comes from having pride in our division. I'm proud to be a Division III student athlete for the reasons not only that I get to compete, but I get to do a lot of other things off the field that someone at a Division I level might not have the opportunity to do. And so I think that's something to always keep in the back of our heads, is that the Division III philosophy is really what we stand for, and the ability to balance that student athlete life, to get involved with other things outside the classroom and off the athletic field, is a benefit of Division III. And that might come at the cost of some other benefits of Division I. But we are a different division, and we should be proud of what we stand for. And keep that in mind as we're going through this legislative and restructuring process of our competitions and practice seasons.
If you can forgive me a slight editorial point, I would say Division III are more student athletes than some in Division I. And I think that's what's something to be proud of as a Division III student athlete. I certainly, one last question I had before I let you go on this one is how important, because this probably isn't going to get voted on in January. Your term as chair and other members on the committee who have their year here will end. How important is it to keep the message, keep the focus and keep the point of view the same from this year's committee to next year's committee, as probably the bulk of the decisions will be made. I guess they could be made in both, but I mean, how important is it to keep at least everything equal so that you're not giving two different messages to the NCAA?
Yeah, that's something that is always an issue as we roll off some members and roll some on. But the way our committee is structured isn't really these are the veterans and these are the rookies. We're really one cohesive unit, and we talk a lot of time about our national hats. And so we have our self hat, which is when you're talking about yourself and your views. You have your conference hat when you're representing your conference, and you have your national SAAC hat, and that's the hat that carries over. So once the year ends at convention, we put on our national SAAC hats, and that's who we speak from. And we portray that message to the entire association and to Division III membership. And that's what we need to carry over each year. And that doesn't mean that just because the veterans that have been on the committee are rolling off, we forget their voices. Their student athletes and their opinions that they gave us last year are something we still talk about in meetings. So we still say, hey, remember when this person said this? This is a really good point we can't forget. And I think the committee respects each other and respects those opinions so much that that's never been a problem for us. We roll over very well in the fact that the opinions and the statements that we put together are very thought out opinions and statements, and that they reflect the committee as a whole and not just one person who might be rolling off.
We're certainly going to look forward to seeing how this all plays out. Looking forward to seeing how the SAAC works in the next year, as you talk about more meetings and certainly communication as well. And we look forward to seeing what you guys do. I'd be remiss if we didn't talk to you as a student athlete. You are a captain, I think two-time captain, if memory serves, of the women's lacrosse team at Stevens. You've had a pretty good season. We won't date our interview too much by indicating where you are in the season, but certainly I know you've certainly had a successful career and you've had a successful year this year. What's it like to be a student athlete in Division III? I ask this of everybody because I always get different answers.
I mean, being a Division III student athlete is such a unique experience. I probably dedicate just as much time on the field as in the classroom, as off the field, as in anything else I do on campus. I consider myself and my teammates and the people I go to school with very balanced student athletes, and I think that's what's really unique. I wouldn't have traded my Division III experience for anything. I was able to get involved in campus activities, off-campus activities. I was able to excel in my academics, and I was able to really put the time in on the field to be a successful student athlete and leave a legacy at Stevens that I'm proud of.
How difficult has it been? Because you're a mechanical engineer. If there's anything that's difficult, there's a lot of them out there as student athletes. Mechanical engineer, just in my head, screams, A, you got to be pretty smart, and B, there's going to be a lot of time spent not only in the classroom but in labs, but also outside the classroom. You're also, as I said, a captain on the women's lacrosse team. Now you're national chair for the SAAC, which means you're in Indianapolis for meetings on occasion. How difficult has just this last semester of your senior year been?
Well, actually, this last semester has been a breeze compared to the other ones. as a senior, I've taken a few less classes, so I'm definitely enjoying the light academic load. But I say light in comparison to everything else, but over my time here, balancing my academics, balancing being on this national committee and having that opportunity and balancing my sport, it is that. It's a balancing act. And sometimes, I guess, you lose sleep over it and the fact that you're up till 2 a.m. doing homework. But you recover and you keep going. And honestly, if anything, it's prepared me for my career, for what I'm going to do after school. And that I know no matter how much work I have, no matter what I have going on, I'll be able to balance it all. And that's something that Division III has taught me, and I've learned a lot here at Stevens.
We should point out, you pretty much jumped on board SAAC, at least at Stevens, the moment you came in. You're very involved in the community with your efforts with Special Olympics and shelters and a lot of other things. You do not seem like someone who sits down and takes a moment off necessarily. You already have a job lined up for when you leave. You'll be working in the area for a pretty good company. Is there anything you think you will miss about your 4 years at Stevens? Though you'll still be attached, obviously, as national chair, but is there anything you think you'll miss, or necessarily that you are going to kind of look back fondly on your career at Stevens and as a student athlete?
Well, I definitely won't miss the hours of homework.
No.
But as I come to that, kind of, we're in postseason this weekend for lacrosse. So as we come over to the end of that experience of being a student athlete is something that's so unique. So getting that chance to compete is definitely something I'm going to miss at a collegiate level. And then just being at college, being able to see my friends every day, to walk to class, to just kind of hang out and explore the New York City area, explore Hoboken, and just kind of have that atmosphere where I'm not going to work every day. I can wake up at 11 a.m. instead of 6 a.m. and that kind of freedom to do that kind of stuff is definitely something that I'll miss. But the hours of homework and the tests are definitely going to be happy to get rid of.
Yeah, I think every student says that with resounding voice. By the way, Stevens, great tradition of having their team pictures taken with a backdrop of Manhattan. Certainly an easy thing when you're living that close to the Hudson. You won't be that far away in Morristown, but certainly maybe not as close either. I want to congratulate you on your student athlete experience. Certainly, reading up on you has been certainly pretty impressive, and I want to at least give my nod of the hat to that. Thank you for joining us on the show. I don't usually do this as a kind of a reference to our basketball show, but we always give the guests the final word. I figured it seemed appropriate to give you the final word here today on this month's edition.
Well, thank you. Thank you for your congratulations and for having me here. I guess my final word would just be that I'm so proud to be a Division III student athlete as I wrap up my career. I couldn't have been happier with the experience that I've had, and I really hope that every Division III student athlete out there remembers why you're there and why you're playing. And you know, this experience is so unique, and I'm lucky enough to have gone through it for 4 years, and I hope every Division III student athlete out there the best. And I know that this is a division to be proud of, and let's remember that going forward.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Amanda Ingersoll, women's lacrosse player and senior captain for Stevens, but more importantly the chair of this year's SAAC. We'll look forward to keeping in touch with her throughout the rest of her tenure.
Thanks, Dave.
Thanks again to Amanda Ingersoll of Stevens. The Ducks women's lacrosse team unfortunately lost in the Empire 8 championship and missed out on an NCAA berth, but when it went on to win the ECAC Mid-Atlantic Region Championship, winning 3 games and defeating Lebanon Valley in the title game 9-7. Coming up on the WhyD3 show, we honor Randolph-Macon College for their efforts to better their community. See why they were honored with the NCAA Diversity Spotlight. Plus, this month's honor roll, which includes a 3-sport, 4-year student athlete. And a recap some of what we spotted during Division III week. But before we go, this month's edition of the WhyD3 in 3 Words Project. We asked schools and students around Division III to submit their WhyD3 in 3 Words. And here's what we got for the month of May.
WhyD3, community, involvement,
opportunities, loyalty, education, teamwork,
dedication, team, and commitment.
WhyD3,
close-knit,
involved,
dedicated,
dedication, perseverance, family,
passion, opportunity,
student athlete, go Dash,
win at everything,
passion, hard work, and balance,
dedication, commitment, pride.
WhyD3,
close-knit,
opportunity,
academics,
go Dash!
Pride, passion, family.
WhyD3,
balance,
family,
education,
go Central!
Fight to finish.
WhyD3,
commitment,
balance,
relationships,
go Dash!
After a season of intense women's college lacrosse, only the top 4 teams remain.
Pops one to the corner!
Be there and experience it live. The excitement.
Score!
The action.
Wow.
The celebration.
They are the national champions.
Witness it all in person. The 2015 NCAA Division I and III Women's Lacrosse Championships. May 22nd through 24th at PPL Park in Philadelphia. Tickets on sale now. Visit ncaa.com/wlacrosse and make a date with champions.
What makes D3 special is the ability to participate in my team and within the broader community.
The perfect ending to a perfect season.
Being a D3 student athlete has completely expanded my life.
I learned how to lead. I really found a voice.
What time is it?
It's more about the experience rather than just a sport itself.
Without the experience of being a Division III student athlete, I wouldn't be the person who I am today.
NCAA Division III. Discover. Develop. Dedicate.
I did receive a non-athletic scholarship upon entering school.
I got the presidential scholarship, which was huge for me.
I think there's more opportunities for academic scholarships in Division III.
I did receive academic scholarships. Just being involved on campus, being a leader, all those things combined kind of get me recognized. It's a great experience for me.
Welcome back to the May edition of the WhyD3 Show. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. It's time to tip our hat, and this time to one school recently honored by the NCAA. The Randolph-Macon Student Athlete Advisory Committee received the Adversity Award for the month of April for their work advocating for all forms of diversity, producing a video that was written by students and calling it #MaconNation. The effort certainly received a boost when one of the men's basketball players came out as being gay and was featured in an interview in Out Sports. He's also featured in the video, which we proudly show for you right now.
Here at RMC, our differences do not separate us.
Our differences make us stronger. We treat each other with respect and dignity.
We value diversity and appreciate what makes us different from our teammates, peers, and competitors.
Because we have one important thing in common.
We are the Yellow Jackets.
We are Macon Nation.
My teammates are my brothers.
My sisters and my family.
We support and encourage each other.
We are the Yellow Jackets.
We are the Macon Nation.
Your race, your religion,
your gender, your sexual orientation,
national origins is not what makes you an athlete,
but it makes you who you are.
Or what makes you who you are.
I believe everyone deserves to live and play
in an environment free from discrimination.
When we step on the court,
when we step on the field,
when we dive in the pool,
we recognize that our words and actions go beyond the sport.
Here at RMC, we realize that we are role models in our community.
The Division III philosophy values cultural diversity and gender equity. Here at Randolph-Macon, we reinforce those values.
So I pledge to step up, to lead, and to break down the barriers of exclusion.
I will not tolerate discrimination
or derogatory language of any kind.
I urge you to step up with me to be the change.
We are the Yellow Jackets. We are the Nation.
Congratulations once again to the students at Randolph-Macon for pushing for all diversity on their campus and in their community. Job well done. Now time for this month's honor roll, and we start in Washington, D.C., where you will find Gallaudet University, the only college in the world dedicated to the deaf and hard of hearing. At their recent athletics awards, Gallaudet took the time to honor senior Elena Ciccarelli, who didn't excel for 4 years in one sport, but in three. Ciccarelli, who is from Whitesboro, New York, located in the upstate region outside of Utica, became the first Bison student athlete to play three different sports in her career. In each of the 4 years at Gallaudet, Ciccarelli lettered in women's soccer, women's basketball, and softball. And while Ciccarelli may not have received an all-conference award for her participation, she was honored for her work in the classroom as a three-time Northeastern Athletic Conference scholar athlete. And sometimes there are just players on teams who lead and give to a team in ways that can't be awarded on the field. Ciccarelli was surprised with a special plaque made in her honor at the end of the athletics banquet this year. Ciccarelli ended up playing 65 games, starting 60 of them in women's soccer as defender, played 101 games, starting 89 in basketball, finishing with over 500 points and nearly 700 rebounds, and played in 130 games, starting 120 in softball, with a great fielding percentage of .939 as an outfielder. Plus, these incredible numbers we got from the Gallaudet Sports Information Department. Ciccarelli played nearly 3,000 minutes of basketball. She played in nearly 300 total games in all three sports. She won 92 of those games in what essentially was 12 seasons of athletics at Gallaudet and for five different coaches. Ciccarelli deserved the standing ovation she got from those in attendance, and we give her our tip of the hat for her accomplishments while being essentially fully deaf. Now to others on our honor roll, especially items we noticed during the fourth annual D3 week in April. At Gettysburg College in South Central Pennsylvania, women's lacrosse senior Mandy Buell is leaving quite a legacy. Buell teamed up with the Gettysburg College Center for Public Service and Project Gettysburg Lyon to build a playground in a small community outside Lyon, Nicaragua. Buell got her teammates on board and organized a 5K race back in November called the Race for Kids. The race raised $1,200 for the playground, and this spring it was installed at a building that doubles as a preschool and healthcare center. The playground features two slides, two sets of swings, and a seesaw, all painted in red, yellow, and blue. And the children of the town made sure to thank Buell and her teammates after testing out the playground thoroughly. In the meantime, Buell and the women's lacrosse team are now focused on trying to win a national championship, the second in program history. The fifth-ranked Bullets are still playing in the Division III Women's Lacrosse Championship Tournament. The Final Four is set to be played at PPL Park outside of Philadelphia alongside the Division I Women's Final Four on Memorial Day weekend. We go from Pennsylvania to California for our next honoree, and that's the University of Laverne, who did a number of things to celebrate Division III week, but this one caught my eye, Dunk Durant. A dunk tank was set up, and student-athletes and staff could donate a dollar to dunk strength and conditioning coach Matt Durant. But the reason for the dunking was more than getting Durant wet.
We're here at the highlight of the Student Athletic Day event with the strength and conditioning coach Matt Durant, where people are going to get a chance to dunk you three tries for $1. Two tries for $1. And so how do you feel about that?
I have every confidence that they're going to miss.
Everyone's going to miss. Who thinks they're going to miss? Okay, it's kind of quiet. So is there all the proceeds, what are they going towards exactly?
I'll fight cerebral palsy.
Okay, is there any specific reason?
Well, my 8-year-old son had a low form of it, and it really shocked me, and it kind of caught me off guard. Kind of made me a little sentimental, and that the student athletes would think about my son first to do something like this. So I thought it was really cool. He asked me to do it. I kind of hemmed it off, and I'm like, you know what? Yes.
All proceeds from the event went to the City of Hope for cerebral palsy research. Job well done, Laverne. And on to Wisconsin, where giving back to your community is exactly what two Wisconsin Stevens Point volleyball players have done, one using the hair on her head to do so. Tiffany Stargardt decided to cut 10 inches of her hair off and donate it to Locks for Love, which is an organization that provides hair pieces to financially disadvantaged children suffering from long-term medical hair loss from any diagnosis. In the meantime, teammate and captain Sarah Brewer decided to start a chapter of the Love Your Melon organization. Love Your Melon strives to improve the lives of children battling cancer and was the brainchild of two University of St. Thomas students in 2012 as part of an entrepreneurship class. Brewer's UWSP team already has 20 members. And speaking of Division III, a social media campaign efforted by the NCAA offices was a success, For every new like of the NCAA Division III Facebook page or follow of the Division III Twitter account during D3 week, $1 was pledged toward Special Olympics from the National Student Athlete Advisory Committee. In all, over $4,300 were donated to Special Olympics North America. And with that, we wrap up this month's honor roll. But we tip our hat to all the student athletes around Division III who are doing things to improve their campuses and communities. That's going to do it for the May edition of the WhyD3 Show. Thank you for watching. We do hope to have a June edition put together before we take a couple months off for the summer. Don't forget, if you want to catch up on previous episodes of the show or you have a story idea for us to share on the show, follow us in the following ways. Our website is www.d3sports.com/WhyD3Show. You can follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/WhyD3Show. Don't forget Twitter at WhyD3Show or use the hashtag WhyD3 to follow everything great going on with student athletes in Division III. And you can email us WhyD3Show@d3sports.com. We welcome all story ideas, whether they are features on student athletes, coaches, teams, administrators, staff, etc., or something we should mention in our honor roll. We love video stories. If you put together a video about a team, your athletics department, a student athlete, or whomever, share that with us as well. We also love short videos showing off something great about the students of Division III. Send your ideas our way, and you just may see them on a future WhyD3 show. And of course, don't forget about the WhyD3 in Three Words project. Pick up a camera and capture student athletes or teams telling us why they love Division III in just three words. It won't take much of your time. Just send them our way. You can find more information at d3sports.com/WhyD3Show/3Words. That's going to do it for now. Thank you for watching, and thank you for all of those who participated in this month's show and for those who helped us put it together. We thank you in detail in our credits. We appreciate you taking the time. Until next time, you've been watching the WhyD3 Show.